All right. It's good to have you joining us this evening. I hope you've had a great day. It's been a beautiful day, really. Not too hot outside, so hopefully you were able to enjoy this weather today. And again, glad that you're joining us this evening as we take some time for some prayer requests and praying over these that have either been sick or currently very sick. And then we'll get into a quick Bible study. But we need to remember Mary Rallett. We need to pray for her. She is very soon going to be taking some chemotherapy. So pray for Mary Rallett. Thankfully, Cindy Ballard is now at home. She spent several days in the hospital, and she is at home. So we praise the Lord for that. But still, yet, she is very, very weak, and she needs our continued prayers. And if you are interested in helping them with meals in the month of July, please see Miss Georgia or Lynn Alexander for that. Kelly Quinn had knee surgery last week, and she's doing very well. Lisa Ruckel had a procedure last week, and thankfully I talked to her earlier today, and she is doing much better. Bernard Simpson fell a couple of times, and, did not do, thankfully, it could have been a lot worse, but he did have to stay in the hospital. He is at home, though, now. Pray for Brother Bernard that the doctors will know exactly why he fell. And then also Dwana Lupke, she has asked for specific prayer requests for her. She has a bad case of the shingles, and she's in a lot of pain. So pray for Dwana Lupke. And I just want to let you know that Renewal Ranch is going to be with us this Sunday. And so we're looking forward to that. This will be our third year in a row to host them. They will be here. Unfortunately, because of the guidelines, the health guidelines, normally they have about 70 folks come, but only about 10 are going to be able to come this Sunday. But nevertheless, we're going to be able to hear some great testimonies of how God is delivering these young men from addiction. So that's this Sunday at 11 o'clock. I want you to join us, if you would, here at the church. Well, if you have a copy of God's Word in front of you, I would invite you to turn to the Old Testament book, Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter number 33. We're going to be reading some words that were penned by the prophet Ezekiel, and words that are very relevant to what we are facing today. And we find in Ezekiel chapter 33 and verse number 1, it says, "Again, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, speak to the children of your people and say to them, when I bring the sword upon a land, and the people of the land take a man from their territory and make him their watchman, when he sees the sword coming upon the land, if he blows the trumpet and warns the people, then whoever hears the sound of the trumpet and does not take warning, if the sword comes and takes him away, his blood shall be on his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet, but did not take warning. His blood shall be upon himself, but he who takes warning will save his life. But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet, and the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at the watchman's hand." That is a very powerful passage of Scripture. And you know, when we listen to those words out of this passage, out of Ezekiel chapter 33, we certainly may not fully understand what he's talking about, having a watchman on the wall and so forth. But you can know for a fact that the Jews to whom had heard this, every Jew who had ever lived in a walled, fortified city knew exactly what Ezekiel was talking about when he referred to the watchman on the wall. And for these watchmen They were very, very important for the city's defense. A faithful watchman kept their eyes focused on the horizon and gave the warning when they saw the enemy approaching. They would sound the trumpet. They would sound the alarm, giving them plenty of time to take action. And if the watchmen were alert, and if the watchmen were faithful to their duty, and on top of that, if the people were obedient to listen to the warning, lives would be saved. But if the watchman on the wall was careless, or if the people were apathetic and unconcerned, the city would then be captured and many people would die. Well, listen, God called Ezekiel to be his watchman. He called him in chapter 3 of this book. And it was his task to hear God's word of warning and then declare it to his people. The faithful watchman, what God said, the faithful watchman had clean hands, but the unfaithful watchman had hands that were stained by the blood of the victims who died because he did not warn them. It's very interesting in Isaiah chapter number 56 that Isaiah compared unfaithful watchmen to blind men. He also compared unfaithful watchmen to dogs who cannot bark and people who cannot stay awake. Well, Ezekiel was a faithful watchman who delivered God's message to the Jews in Babylon, but also to those back in Judah of the word of God. And he gave them that warning. And I say again that this is a very relevant passage of Scripture today of what we're facing here in our own country. And I believe what we are seeing in our nation right at this moment can be likened to that of a tsunami, of a major tidal wave that is getting ready to hit the shore. And one thing that is interesting about the tsunamis that do hit is that before they make their way to the shore, they always give out some kind of warning. There's always some kind of a warning before they hit. And this warning is seen by how the waters recede back from the shoreline in a very eerie way. The seafloor, then, that is normally covered by the water is now easily seen as the waters make their way back into the ocean. You may remember several years ago that tsunami that hit Thailand and other parts of that region, killing thousands upon thousands of people. And it did so because so many people did not heed the warnings. The tourists saw this rare phenomena and were just, their eyes were just fixed upon this rare thing of these waters receding back from the shoreline and then exposing so much of the seafloor that was normally underwater. And because they just stood there in amazement and stood there in awe, they were swept away and killed. But it's very interesting, the natives of Thailand didn't do this. The natives, when they saw the waters receding, they knew that was a warning. And what did they do? They ran to higher ground, and thus they found safety. Friends, let me tell you something. This is where we are at today in our country. Really, they have been this way for years. We've been seeing the warning signs, but we've, for the most part, neglected to heed them. And right now, we are starting to see the waters receding back into the sea, at an alarming rate, something that we've never seen before. Many are so spellbound at what they're seeing, but yet are apathetic. They're unconcerned. And sadly, it seems that few are actually concerned at all at what they're seeing, and they're willing to move, go about their everyday business unconcerned about what they're seeing. You say, Brother Wade, what kind of tsunami are you talking about figuratively that's going to hit our country? Well, I'm talking about a tsunami of extreme liberalism. I'm talking about a tsunami, a tidal wave of really what is cultural Marxism. It is getting ready to engulf our entire society. And when it does, we all will be affected. And again, we're seeing this warning signs by these rioters and these folks who spend hours and hours during the night trying to tear down these statues. And like I said the other day, it really has nothing to do with statues that they're tearing down. They want to tear down every semblance of our Western civilized republic. And when it does hit, when this tsunami of cultural Marxism hits our country, listen, there will be no higher ground for us to run to. It'll be too late. There will be no place that we can run to hide from this lethal deluge. And I say it's lethal because it really is. Not so much physically, but with the many things that we have taken for granted today, one major liberty that will inevitably be taken from us when this tsunami hits of this cultural Marxism is religious liberty. You can count on that. That will be inevitably one of the first things they take from us is religious liberty. And really there's something that we must understand and something that we must know is that religious liberty is not a secular value. We have to come to grips with that. It is not just a secular value. Religious liberty is a Christian value. The foundations for the democratic ideal of religious liberty have their roots deeply in the Holy Scriptures. And what is sad and what is very true is that we as believers, we as Christians, have absolutely taken our liberties, our religious liberties, for granted. And we have for years. You know, the truth is, we should have loved and cherished them more. We should have loved and cherished those liberties more than what we have had. We should have attended public worship services more. We should have shared the gospel more. We should have spoken out for biblical values and social issues more than what we have ever done in the past. We should have encouraged Christians to run for public office more than we ever did. We should have sent missionaries to evangelize our own country on top of other countries of the world. We should have exposed and stood against those who opposed such religious freedoms. But we didn't do that. For years, we neglected to do that. And so instead of opposing them, what did we do? We appeased them. instead of opposing them, we appeased them. And I like what C.S. Lewis said about this thing of appeasement. He said, appeasement is much like feeding a crocodile. You are just hoping that you will be the last one he eats. And that's exactly what we have done in our country. Instead of opposing their ideologies that are anti-God, we have appeased them and somehow tried to make peace with them. And so because we have largely appeased this godless culture, we're starting to see a great uprising, unlike never before, maybe since the Civil War. We should have taken a stronger stand. And again, that should have happened years ago. We should have stood stronger when God was removed from our public school system, when prayer was removed. We should have stood stronger against when the Ten Commandments were taken down from our public schools and even our courthouses. But we did not, and we, for the most part, just stood idly by and didn't say anything. We appeased them, and now in that appeasement, we have created this monster of liberalism that is ready to take this country over. And we're being very close to being overwhelmed and inundated with this godless culture that is not going to be a friend to true believers. I can promise you that. And we need to understand, and please know, that if these God-hating cultural Marxists win, we let them win. I mean, that's the honest truth. If they win, if they succeed, we have let them. We could have beaten them. When we first saw these things years ago, when prayer being removed out of school and God taken out of government institutions and so forth, and the passing of the legislation or the Supreme Court ruling of Roe versus Wade, we should have done more then, but we did not. We could have beaten them, but too many Christians then, and even now, are spineless cowards. Listen, God does not give glorious victories. He does not give victories to his people when they are cowards. I pray that in these days that God would raise up some men and some women with backbone, with a backbone that would have the courage to take a stand. But it's very true. God never gives victories to those people who are cowards. I mean, my goodness, just read the Old Testament. It is a prominent theme throughout the Old Testament that whenever Israel adopted the practices of neighboring pagans, in order to appease them, and in order to win their approval, then God forsook his people. God forsook them, and he let them get weaker and weaker. And we know that throughout Israel's history, he would then deliver them into the hands of their enemies. And friend, let me tell you something. That is the Christian church in America. That is where we are at. She is largely pathetic. She is largely cowardly. She pathetically wants to win the favor of a society that hates her and hates her message. And so this lukewarmness absolutely makes God sick. That's what he said in Revelation chapter 3. He said, I'd rather you be hot or cold, but now that you're lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. That is what we're seeing today. We are reaping the results of lukewarm Christianity. We're reaping the results of a lukewarm church. And so he may very well let us fall to our enemies. And so my call to you today is this: to look around and heed the warnings. See the hatred that people have for our country. See the hatred that they had for our police. Hey, listen, these people want to defund our police force, our law enforcement. These people, and they have stated they want to see prisons empty. They want to see those who have been committed for murder and rape and all those things empty. And the reason is because they feel like that the judicial system that is in our country has been founded upon white people. And because of that, it is systematically racist. And so therefore, every person who has been found guilty is really ultimately innocent. And they're only guilty because of the judicial system that was predominantly, well, white. But that's so false, so wrong. But my goodness, could you imagine living in a society if they had their way and let out every prisoner? It is unbelievable. It is a sick way of thinking. But my dear friend, if we do nothing, our time of knowing religious liberty is short. It's very short. And so I ask you tonight that if you would please pray that God would have mercy upon us. Pray that God would raise up some men and women with backbone of every color, black, white, people that would think with their minds and have logic and have sense. And then I'd also ask you that God would give wisdom to leaders who are in authority. Our government right now needs our prayers, those who are in authority, to know how to handle this situation. And I also ask you to pray for the spiritual leaders, us as pastors, that we would know exactly how to fight this in a organized, systematic way. Friend, listen to me. The only wall of defense right now in our country that stands between our Christian liberties and the tidal wave of this liberalism that is bound to hit us, the only wall of defense is the church. That's it. I mean, we're seeing today, unlike any time before, businesses cowering down, bowing down to this group faster than you can even keep up with. Major corporations, Amazon and Google, all those major corporations, Walmart, are bowing down. So now, where it used to hit a brick wall with the businesses, now those businesses have taken down that wall, and so it's up to the church. It is up to us to stand, and so we must stand, and then we must vote. We've got to vote. If you have never voted before, my goodness, you need to vote now and have wisdom, have spiritual discernment in your vote. And please understand that Biden, I'm just going to be very candid with you this evening, Biden is nothing more than a shell of a man that the liberals, the cultural Marxists are using to ride upon his back to get into power. He's nothing that he has no solutions whatsoever to calm the ills of this nation. And what he is just their ticket to get into office. And you must have the wisdom and the logic to look past that. And so we must, more in any time in our lives. Get down on our knees, but then put those prayers to action. We've got to do something. We've got to act fast. I'm concerned that it may be too late, but it's not over yet. I have my children and my grandchildren that I'm fighting for. And I know you do as well. And so I challenge you to stand up, sound the alarm, and may many heed the warning. Let's pray together. Our Father, Lord, we are thankful, Lord, that we know that you are sovereign over all. And we are thankful for that you are in complete control. And Father, we do pray that you would raise up some men and women that would stand up against a culture that is against them. Father, I pray for our young people in our country. Lord, they have been blinded. And it's our fault. We have allowed them to be educated with a school system, a public school system that has never taught them the history of our country. We have taught them really, essentially, in a horrible way of thinking. Father, I pray that you give them sight, Lord, to see the culture for what it is. I pray for our churches, Lord, that you give us wisdom, give us a backbone, and give us the courage that we desperately need for this hour. And Father, we love you. We ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, I pray that you have a blessed rest of your evening.